It's my pleasure to welcome all of you first time in the new year, 2024, and our first distinguished guest today is Professor Justyna Łagoda. Professor Łagoda did a PhD in the Warsaw University Physics Department in 2006, and her topic was the projection chamber for investigation of neutrino interactions. The supervisor was Professor Wojciech Dominik. And after that, she worked in the Institute for Nuclear Research, and also she was a postdoctoral fellow in Laboratorio Nazionale del Gran Sasso, where she worked also with neutrino experiments. Professor Łagoda is still employed in the National Center for Nuclear Research, and she's now assistant professor, associate professor since 2016 when she did habilitation. And she's a member of a number of important experiments and collaborations, Super Kamiokande and Hyper Kamiokande, and also T2K neutrino experiment. In 2015, together with the team, they received a very important prize, the Breakthrough Prize for the discovery of neutrino oscillations. It was awarded by several companies, including Google. And now Professor Łagoda is a representative of Poland in the European Committee for Future Accelerators. She is the selected person from Poland to represent us in this board of experts. And today we have a pleasure to hear the lecture about neutrino oscillations and current experimental results. Welcome.
Thank you very much. Thanks for the organizers for inviting me and giving me the opportunity to present you the current experimental results in neutrino physics and also some prospects for the near and more distant future. So for the beginning, let me remind you some facts about the neutrino oscillations. So as we believe now, the neutrino flavor eigenstates are the linear combinations of the mass eigenstates, and the matrix which connects them is called usually Pontecorvo-Makina-Kagawa-Sakata matrix, and is usually parameterized by three mixing angles and one violating phase delta CP. The parameters of the mixing can be measured using various sources of the neutrinos and various experimental techniques which cover a wide range of energies and of so-called baselines. So for example, the sector 2-3 is measured in atmospheric and accelerator experiments, sector 1-2 in solar and reactor experiment, and the sector 1-3 in accelerator and reactor measurements. In the frame, you can see the general formula for the probability of neutrino going from flavor state alpha to flavor state beta. And as you can notice, we have some more parameters than just mixing angle and the CP violating phase, which are the neutrino energy, the baseline, so this is the distance between the production and detection point, and the delta M squared, which we usually called also mass splittings, sorry, which is the difference between the squared mass of the masses of the mass eigenstates. This is the general formula in vacuum. If the neutrino is propagating through matter, we have to take into account the presence of the electrons, which modifies the propagation of the electron flavor component of the beam. This is called matter effects or MSW effects. This is from Mikhaev, Smirnov, Wolfenstein, and the physicist which described this. This is important because the presence of matter may enhance the oscillations in the resonant way, as you will see later. The neutrino oscillation can be measured in two ways. So first, we can look at the disappearance. So we are starting with a beam of a given flavor of neutrinos, and look how many of them will survive to the detection point. This can be done for any flavor and for practically any energy. As the result in the detection point, we can see the pattern like that. When this is the deficit due to the oscillation, and from the location of this dip, we can measure the delta m squared, the mass splittings of this dominant oscillations. And from the depth of that, we can measure the strength effect, so the mixing sine squared of the mixing angle. The CPT conservation requires that the survival probability has to be the same for neutrinos and antineutrinos. The other possibility, appearance channel, is the direct observation of the flavor change. So we start with the neutrinos of a given flavor, for example, muon neutrinos, and after some distance, we look for the new flavor, like electron neutrinos, which should appear in the beam. And this is more difficult to do because this is not possible for all the sources of the neutrinos or all the flavors. For example, we have the good sources of electron neutrinos and neutrinos like sun and the reactors, but for them the appearance channel is not possible simply because of the energies which are below the threshold for the production of the corresponding charge lepton. The energy range of solar and reactor neutrinos are about few MeV, and the mass of muon or tau is over 100 MeV, so they cannot produce it. And the presence of the charged lepton is the only way that we can say what was the flavor of the neutrino. The other channel, like nu mu going into nu tau, is very challenging because the tau lepton has a large mass, so the threshold for its production is really large. It is extremely short-lived, so it is really difficult to observe it, and only one experiment, OPERA, did it in 2015. Another possible channel, nu mu into nu e, is subdominant. So it's the amount of electron neutrinos appearing in the beam of muon neutrinos is not much. And it was discovered in 2013. I will tell more about that in the future. And as for nu tau, well, we don't have good nu tau sources which can produce nu tau beam for experiments. This is the current knowledge about the oscillations parameters. And this plot shows you how the precision of our measurements changed a long time since the discovery till several years ago. So you can see that we're really starting with very not precise measurements, but now we really achieved in some cases very, very good precision. But of course there are still questions which are waiting for the answer, which are waiting for new experimental results. And in my talk, I will cover the questions related to the neutrino oscillation. I will not speak about direct mass measurements, nature of the neutrinos or origin of the masses, but I will speak about the so-called mass ordering. So because we don't know what is the ordering of the mass states, we know that M2 is heavier than M1. This we know from the solar experiments, but we don't know if the M3 is the heaviest or the lightest of the mass states. We don't know also in which octant the mixing angle theta 2-3 lies, because you can notice that it is very close to the maximal mixing. So the theta 2-3 is very close to 45 degrees, but in fact it is maybe in the lower octant, or maybe the upper octant, or maybe it is just 45 degrees precise. We don't know yet. And the probably most important thing is the existence of CP violation in the neutrino sector. We have some hints coming also from the T2K experiment that the CP may be very strongly violated in the neutrino sector, but this is still limited result. The errors, the uncertainties are still too large to conclude that CP is for sure violated. So this is the outline of the rest of my talk. I will first speak a few words about the prize which was given at the EPS conference in Hamburg last year, when I had also the pleasure to give similar talk. Then I will speak about the recent results and plans from the reactor neutrino experiments, then from atmospheric neutrino experiments and accelerator neutrino experiments. At the end, I will also mention some results related to the so-called sterile neutrinos. So in August in Hamburg, the prize of the High Energy and Particle Physics Division was given to Professor Cecilia Jarskog for the discovery of the invariant measure of CP violation in quark and lepton sectors, and to two leaders of the or maybe not leaders, but to the two collaborations which measured the mixing angle theta 1-3. Why this was so important? Why they got this prize? If you look at this formula, this is the probability of the transition of muon neutrinos into electron neutrinos, and it is almost full formula. So you can notice here that we have dominant term, which is governed by the mixing angle theta 1-3. Then we have some terms which are less important. Here we have the term in which we have the CP violation. We have the sign of theta CP of delta CP, which changes sign when we switch neutrinos and antineutrinos. This, the probability for neutrinos and antineutrinos may be different. And here also we have the term related to the matter effect, which I mentioned before, which also change the probability a little. So if you look here, this part of the formula, which is in the frame, is so-called the Jarl-Skog invariant, which is independent of the parametrization of the mixing matrix. And if we substitute all the known mixing angle here, we can see that the value of this invariant may be 0.033 times the sine of theta of delta CP. In case if sine of theta CP is close to 1 or minus 1, we have like 0.033, which for comparison for quark sector is much smaller. That means that the CP violation has the potential to be much stronger than in quark sector, which would help to answer the questions why we have matter-dominated universe. This channel is also sensitive to the octant of theta 2-3 angle, and thanks to the presence of this term here, it is also sensitive to the mass ordering, because the matter effects are sensitive to the matter ordering. So this is kind of a golden channel in our studies, because we have all the effects in one channel. Of course, we have to distinguish between them. And here you can see what is the relative size of these effects. So the leading term, the red one, the CP violating term, the matter term, this is for some particular set of parameters assumed. So the measurement of theta 1-3 was extremely important. If we go back to 2011, only the upper limit for this angle was known from the Chose reactor experiment. And the neutrino physicists were really afraid that this angle may be very small. And as you saw, this angle is governs the dominant term. So if that angle would be very small or zero, that would make the search for the CP violation in neutrinos much more difficult or of even impossible. There were some weak indications of the non-zero theta 1-3 from experiments like T2K and Doubleshaw, but the statistical significance was limited. And in March 2012, Daya Bay experiments, a reactor experiment built in China, here you can see some of its detectors, announced the measurement of the non-zero theta 1-3 at over 5 sigma, which was soon confirmed by the Reno experiment, a Korean experiment built in very similar technique with almost 5 sigma. Here you can see the measured spectrum of the reactor neutrinos, and the ratio between the measured spectrum and the spectrum expected without oscillations. So you can see this red line is the fit and shows the oscillation pattern. The Daya Bay and Reno were continuing their measurements over several years, and not so long ago, Daya Bay announced the final results for the over 5.5 million of the inverse beta decay events in which they detected neutrinos. This is the largest sample of reactor antineutrinos ever taken. And this is the most precisely measured neutrino mixing angle. So it was measured as the last one, but it's the most precisely measured now. And here you can see again the oscillations patterns for this large amount of data, very clean and very nice. This plot shows the allowed region for the oscillation parameters. On one axis, we have the sine of the theta 1-3 angle. On the other side, the delta m squared for reactor neutrinos. The corresponding plot for Reno. and the comparison of measurements from different experiments. So here is the most precise measurement from Daya Bay. This is not the end of the history with reactor neutrinos, because you can still make more measurements with them. So here you can see the formula for the probability of the survival of the reactor electron antineutrinos. And you can notice that in this term here we have delta m squared 3.1 and delta m squared 3.2. So if we plot this probability, then you can notice that we have some, this red line is because of the dominant term, the blue one, the blue wiggles are because of this term. And if we translate the probability into the spectrum of the expected spectrum of the antineutrinos, you can see that we have some small difference between the red and blue lines. And the red and blue lines correspond to the two situation. When delta m squared 3.1 is larger than delta m squared 2, this is called normal hierarchy, or when the situation is opposite, which is so-called inverted hierarchy or inverted ordering. And if we are able to distinguish between the red and blue lines in our detector, then we can determine the mass ordering in the neutrinos. So the resolution of the energy is about 3%, which is needed. And actually the detector which is built now in China and called Juno, which will use the liquid scintillation as the detector techniques, claims that the sensitivity to the neutrino mass ordering will reach 3 sigma significance in six years with some assumed thermal power of the reactors which are producing the neutrinos. So the detector is very, very complicated. It has very large photo coverage, so very small blind spots on the inside. They have also the very complicated and calibration system to achieve such energy resolution and energy scale precision. And this is the current status of Juno. As I said, it will be built in China. There are two electric plants in the distance of about 50 kilometers. And this is the acrylic sphere in which we have the photomultiplier systems installed, and inside there will be the liquid scintillator from which the light will be emitted and observed by the photomultipliers, and everything is also immersed in water Cherenkov Veto detector. This table shows you the expected precision after 6 years for the selected oscillations parameter to which the experiment is sensitive, and comparison with current precision. So as you can see, if everything works well, then we will have very, very good knowledge of this of these parameters in the future. But the mass ordering may be determined not only using reactor neutrinos, but also using atmospheric neutrinos. So atmospheric neutrinos are produced in the atmosphere of Earth by the primary cosmic rays, which collide with the nuclei in the atmosphere and covers wide range of energies and baselines, as you can see on this plot, which shows the energy spectrum. And the baseline may be determined by the direction of which this neutrino is coming. If it's coming from below, that means that it had to go through the whole Earth, so over 10,000 kilometers. If it came from above, then the distance was like several kilometers. And here, since the neutrinos are going through the Earth, through the matter, they experience the matter effect, which causes the enhanced oscillation probability. This is the so-called oscillogram. It shows you the probability in color of the oscillations as the function of energy and the cosine of the zenith angle. So the matter effects cause the enhanced oscillations for the neutrinos in case of normal ordering, but no such effect for antineutrinos. But if the ordering is inverted, then this effect would appear for antineutrinos and not for neutrinos. So if we can measure that, we can use the atmospheric neutrinos in this energy range for determining the mass ordering. And in fact, such measurements are starting, let's say, because the precision is still small, And one of the experiments which does it is Super Kamiokande, which last year passed the 25th anniversary of the discovery of the neutrino oscillation by this experiment. And last year, the Super Kamiokande published new results with so-called four Super Kamiokande pure water phase. Pure water means that really the detector contained only water, because in 2020, the detector was doped with salts of gadolinium to enhance its sensitivity to some cosmological neutrinos. So this analysis used also so-called expanded volume, fiducial volume, so more events in the same, more events, and also increased the lifetime, so increased really all the data taken in this pure water period. They introduced also so-called neutron tagging, which allows to better separate neutrinos from antineutrinos in the detector. And also they use the external constraints, this famous theta 1-3 measurement from the reactor experiment, which allows us to better, to be more sensitive to the other neutrino oscillation parameters. So these are the results published by SuperK. They were checking the delta CP, delta CP parameter. So as you can see here, this is the plot showing the delta chi square as the function of possible values of delta CP. So we are looking for the minimum. You can see that they prefer the maximal violation of delta CP. And also these lines are for inverted and normal ordering. So you can see that also they prefer the normal ordering. This plot shows the preferred values of the theta to 3 angle. So as you can see, Super K prefers the lower octant of this angle. What is also important, Super Kamiokande made a new measurement concerning searching for the tau neutrino appearance. As I said, this is very, very difficult measurement, in particular in a Cherenkov detector like Super Kamiokande, when you cannot see the tau lepton itself, only the production, only the products of the of its decay. So here, SuperK used the neural network to identify the tau events for upward going events, because we only expect the tau appearance to happen if the neutrino were oscillating, so coming from below, not from above. And here you can see the fraction of tau events which are beautifully filling this gap between the other events, mu mu and new events, and the simulated events, and the data marked as points here. The tau events are not only important because the tau appearance is interesting, but also they constitute the background to the mass ordering study. So the better we know the probabilities of tau neutrino appearance and the cross section of tau neutrinos, the better we can constrain the systematic uncertainties for the mass ordering studies in the future. There are two more experiments which are measuring atmospheric neutrinos. One of them is IceCube, which is located in the South Pole and uses the one cubic kilometer of ice, which is equipped with photomultipliers, which observe Cherenkov radiation emitted by the particles produced in neutrino interactions. So they have some very densely instrumented so-called deep core, which can observe GEV scale neutrinos, because in general, this experiment is designed to observe the very high energy neutrinos. They announced new results with new reconstructions with convolutional neural network last year, and for large over 9 years data sample. And here you can see the observed spectrum of the neutrinos compared to the expectations without oscillations. So the signal from oscillations is clear. And here you can see the region of allowed values on the plane of sine squared of theta 2 3 and delta m squared 3 2 with comparison to other experiments, all the results from other experiments. So as you can see, this experiment is compatible and also very competitive to the other experiments like Super Kamiokande. The other one is called KM3 net ORCA, and this is experiment which is currently under construction in Mediterranean Sea, when the photomultipliers constructed as such modules, such multi-photomultipliers, are immersed in the water of the sea, deep underwater, and in plan there is plan to deploy over 100 of strings, each containing 20, if I remember correctly, such photomultipliers. Now about 20 is deployed, but the first results were published for only 6. And even for those only 6, they see the oscillation pattern. They can produce some allowed range of the oscillation parameters, which is compatible with other experiments. However, it's not competitive yet. But if they this black region is what they expect to see after the detector will be fully constructed. They also consider the so-called joint analysis together with the Juno experiment, and this plot shows you how fast they can achieve the sensitivity to the mass ordering in time. So you can compare the joint analysis in green with the separate analysis done by KM3Net or Juno, and you can see that the joint analysis will really allow to know the answer if the mass ordering is normal or inverted in about two to three years after starting of the experiment. Okay, so the next topic is the accelerator neutrinos, which also measure the theta 2-3 angle, but much more. These neutrinos are created from the pion decays in flight. Pions are created by hitting protons on targets, and then the outgoing particles are focused by magnetic horns and directed into decay volume when they decay. At the end, you have very narrow beam of neutrinos, of muon neutrinos. Additionally, we use so-called off-axis technique, which I can explain if anyone is interested later. And this is a beam composed mostly of muon neutrinos, and contains very small admixtures of intrinsic electron neutrinos, mostly from the case of kaons. The experiments with the beam use so-called NIR detectors to control the flux and cross-section uncertainties. And they measure the disappearance of the muon neutrinos and appearance of electron neutrinos at fixed baseline and energy. So they can also take data in neutrino on antineutrino mode, because if you switch the current in the magnetic horns here, you can focus positive or negative pions and obtain the beam of muon neutrinos or antineutrinos. So these experiments are sensitive to theta 2-3 octant, size of the CP violation, and mass ordering if the baseline is large enough. There are two experiments of this kind currently running. One is T2K and the other is NOVA. T2K is in Japan, the baseline is about 300 kilometers. NOVA is in US and the baseline is much longer, so the matter effects are much more important in their case. The detectors have different spectra, different baseline, as you see, different techniques for the detection, so everything is different. Only this physical effect which they want to measure is the same. So they are very complementary. Here you can see the comparison of the energy spectrum of the beam. Here you can see the range covered by this the peaks of the energy spectrum compared to what type of interactions are dominant in this region. So for T2K, it is quasi-elastic events, which is very important, because for this event, you can reconstruct the energy by just measuring the outgoing lepton. And here you can see some numbers. What is important, I put this table here just to show you what numbers of events we have in our experiments. So you can see that it's not huge. It's not like at LHC. We have to deal with the number of events at the more or less 100. That means that we will have quite big statistical uncertainties yet. The analysis of the oscillations in both experiments is also different. I will give some general image of that. So in T2K, the flux and cross-section are parameterized, and these parameters can be constrained from these big red boxes to these small crosses by using the information from the NIR detector. Then, after finding the best values of this cross-section flux parameters, we can apply them to the simulation of the near of the far detector and constrain the uncertainties in the far detector. As you can see here, these are the samples in which we are looking for the new disappearance and new E appearance. If we would not use the near detector, we would have this blue errors. After using near detector, we have these red boxes. So the uncertainties are suppressed thanks to the near detector. And here you can see the comparison of the simulation and the data. And this again for the same samples. And this table summarizes the size of the systematic uncertainties for these samples. So as you can see, most of them are about or below 5%, with the exception of the channel with pion production. In NOVA, this is different. NOVA measures the new mu and new e events in the near detector. So we obtain some reconstructed energy spectrum, then translated this reconstructed energy spectrum into true energy spectrum using simulations, then applies some geometrical corrections and then the oscillation probabilities to obtain the true energy spectrum expected in the far detector. And again, after by using simulations, translates this true energy spectrum into the reconstructed energy spectrum, which is then compared to the data. This is how NOVA does it. Here you can see the comparison of the expectations and data for the new mu and anti-new mu samples for NOVA, and here for the new E and anti-new E samples. Comparing to other measurements, they published some new results using the Bayesian analysis, which is also used in T2K, but this is maybe not very relevant. So let's go to the comparison of data of results from T2K and NOVA. Let's start with the atmospheric parameters, so theta 23 and delta m squared 32. Here you can see the results from the T2K for the frequentist analysis with reactor constraints, and the same for NOVA. And you can see that they both prefer the theta 23 to be lying in the upper octant, and also the range allowed within 90% of confidence level is more or less the same. So these results are very, very compatible. What is interesting that if we do not apply the reactor constraint, then the preferred value in both cases changes to the lower octant. So if this theta 1-3 angle would be larger, then the lower octant would be selected by an analysis, which is quite interesting, and we'll see what will happen when we gather more data. Anyway, this upper octant is preferred by the lower octant, as you can see, still is included within the 68% confidence level. Okay, if it goes to the CP violation, here the situation is more interesting. So let's start to look from this plot, which shows you the results for the delta CP from the frequentist analysis in T2K, which means we should look for the minimum of the delta chi-square function. So it's here. So this value is the very close to maximal violation of CP. This is confirmed by the Bayesian analysis. In this case, we are looking for maximal posterior probability, so this region. And you can see these are in very good agreement. So what T2K prefers is the almost maximal CP violation. The CP conservation is excluded at 90%. And there is also some weak preference for the normal ordering, which is blue in this plot. Okay. On the other hand, NOVA observes both new E appearance and new E appearance and anti-new appearance. So such results disfavors the combination of mass ordering and delta CP, which predict large asymmetry. So this region, which is favored by T2K, which mostly observes new E appearance, but very, very weak signal of anti-new appearance, this region is excluded by NOVA actually. So they prefer this region unless the ordering is inverted. In such case, this region is preferred. So it looks like there is something maybe going here. We can also look for the at the Yarskog invariant. If we want to forget about the parameterization and fit just the Yarskog invariant and see what happens. So these are the results for T2K. We assumed prior flat prior or in delta CP or on sine delta CP, just in case, because we don't know which one is true. But regardless, the conclusions are the same. Strong CP violation. In case of NOVA, again, for the inverted ordering, strong CP violation. For the normal ordering, so what are the conclusions from this comparison? So we can say that both experiments show a weak preference for normal ordering of neutrino masses. There, it looks like there is some tension in delta CP, but you have to remember these results are statistically limited. As I showed you, we have about 100 events. Also, if the ordering, which is true in the nature, is inverted, they agree perfectly. So when I say the results are statistically limited, what that means? Here you can see the data from the T2K as the points. And the blue, this is green. Green histograms shows you the prediction if we assume the T2K parameters. And the red shows you the predictions if we assume that NOVA parameters are the true ones. As you can see, the difference is very, very small. So really, the only conclusion which can be drawn from this comparison is that we need more data in both experiments, because then we will see if the data prefer one or the other solution. We cannot like say anything more about that now. So in fact, the more data will be taken or are taken now. Both experiments are undergoing upgrades. So beam power in both experiments will increase, resulting in much more neutrinos in the beam. And also the T2K is undergoing the upgrade. They are changing the ND280 near detector. The gadolinium is added in the far detector, as I said. And the goal of both experiments is to reach 3 sigma sensitivity. In case of T2K for the CP violation, in case of NOVA for the mass ordering. And also there are some so-called joint fits performed. So T2K and T2K beam data and supercamiocant atmospheric data are taken together and analyzed together. This is the results which are published in November, I think. As you can see, if we sum the data from T2K and SK, again, strong preference for CP violation. Here is the delta CP result. Here is the Yarskog invariant result, and strong and not so strong preference for the upper octant. The T2K and NOVA also performing the joint analysis, but the results are not official yet, so I cannot show them unless, like, probably they will be official in March. I forgot to say, sorry, that this joint fit of SK and T2K also gave a stronger preference for normal ordering bias factor at the level of 9, which is not very strong, but stronger than either of the experiments alone. After T2K and NOVA will finish take data, we will have 2 new experiments. Which are under construction now. One is Dune in the US with very long baseline, over 1,000 kilometers, and broad spectrum, which will cover the two oscillations maxima, giving more sensitivity to the oscillations and CP violation in particular. NOVA will be equipped with large liquid argon detectors, which will be placed underground. In phase 1, they will have two such modules. In phase 2, they plan to build 2 more. And this experiment is, as I said, under construction. The civil works will be completed this year, and the detector construction is underway. The other experiment is Hypercamiocante. This one will be built in Japan. The same baseline as 42K, almost 300 kilometers. The same beam as T2K, with higher power, and the far detector will be built in the same technology as Super Kamiokande, but will be much bigger. As you can see, a big plane can be fitted inside the tank. So this experiment will use the upgraded near detector from T2K, this huge detector built in the Japanese Alps, and also a new intermediate detector is planned, which will measure with better precision the beam and also the cross-section parameters, in particular related to oxygen nuclei. These are some pictures from the construction of the underground tunnels. And also, since we had the collaboration meeting in October, we had also chance to visit this huge experimental hall. This is the top of where the top of the detector will be in person. Now I will show you some frightening plots, but I will try to explain them one by one. So when these experiments will start, let's see what they can see after passing of several years of data taking. So first of all, since Dune has large baseline, it is very sensitive to the matter effects, which gives sensitivity to the mass ordering. So as you can see, if the delta CP is close to the value preferred by T2K now, so if the CP variation is strong, Dune will be able to determine the mass ordering after 1 year of data taking. If the delta CP will have any possible value, then after about 2 to 2.5 years, the mass ordering will be known. Okay, so in such case, Hyper-K starts to play the main role, because if the mass ordering is known, they need about 2-3 years to exclude the CP conservation for the current preferred value of T2K. This is the black line. If the delta CP is smaller, like pi 4, for example, then it will take some more time, but still that will be several years to exclude such scenario or confirm such scenario. After about 10 years, both experiments will reach very high sensitivity to half of possible delta CP values. This is this blue band, or 60% of the allowed values in case of Hyper-K. So really, we hope that these two experiments after 10 years will answer at least two of the most important questions in the oscillation physics. I want to stress one more thing. If you can see here, we have in fact 3 black and 3 red lines. These lines correspond to different systematic uncertainties. So the best line is, of course, for the no systematics at all. The worst line is for the systematics at the current level, and the middle line is for the systematics as we hope to achieve in the future. So you can see that systematics has a huge impact on the predicted sensitivity, and we really have to do everything to suppress the errors as much as possible. And there are many efforts to do that. These are the new cross-section measurements performed by many dedicated experiments. There are theoretical efforts to improve the models which describe the neutrino interactions. There are ideas of using movable near detectors in Dune and also in Hyper-K. This intermediate detector which I mentioned, this is supposed to be moving, because when you go away from the beam, the spectrum changes, so you can measure the cross-section for different beams and then extract the most precise information. Also, there are a lot of effort going into better control of the beam in the detector, in the experiment. There are new concepts of the measurements. There are new concepts of creation of the beam using different techniques than just pion decay. This is the subject for another seminar. And there are also the new detector ideas. Up to now, I was talking about the oscillations of 3 neutrinos, 3 flavors, 3 mass states. But there are some results which suggest that maybe there is another neutrino which is existing, 4th neutrino. And this 4th neutrino would be the delta m squared for this 4th neutrino would be at the level of about 1 electron volt squared. which is very, very far away from the known delta m squareds, which are at the level 10 to minus 3 and 10 to minus 5. But we know from the measurements at lab and we know from the cosmology that the number of active neutrinos should be 3. So this third neutrino would be something else, something which does not interact with matter. And that's why the name for such neutrinos is sterile neutrinos. The experimental hints that we have were provided by the LSND experiment and then confirmed by Mini-Boon experiment. This is, I will speak in more details about that in a moment. We have another anomaly which was observed in the reactor neutrinos, and we have the anomaly, so-called gallium anomaly, when we observed lower event rates for neutrinos for the very strong radioactive sources than we expected. So let's go one by one. First, reactor. So for reactors, the precise measurements which were done at the beginning of at about 2010, when the new experiments were in preparation, observed that the neutrino flux is lower than expected, and that can be interpreted as the deficit due to the oscillations. This was mostly because new predictions for the reactor flux were calculated. Predictions can be made in two ways. First, you can include all the possible decays of various isotopes which can appear in the reactor fuel and sum all the contributions, but it is extremely difficult because you have about 6,000 possible beta decays in such process. The other method is called conversion method, and it's based on measured spectrum of electrons. And from the spectrum of electrons, you can deduct the contributions from various decays and convert the electron spectra to the neutrino spectra. In such in such prediction, usually about 30 decays are considered. So these models based on both summation and conversion method were recently improved and corrected thanks to the new measurements of the reactor event rates done, among other, by Deyabay and Reno experiments. And these new measurements disfavor models with higher flux predictions. This publication summarizes very nicely the different models and different measurements. And the conclusion is that the favored models, which are best, which describe the data best, are compatible with no oscillation and short baseline. So the reactor neutrino anomaly, which was previously at the level of 3 sigma, after improving the, after improving flux predictions, was decreased to about 1 sigma. However, still not everything in the flux we understand. The other anomaly, gallium anomaly, was recently confirmed by the BEST experiment, which measured the flux of neutrinos coming from very strong radioactive source in the volume of gallium, and they observed about 20% less neutrinos than expected. So if that is due to the oscillations, that would imply very strong effects, so very large mixing. So on this plot, the preferred values would lie in this region. Here you have the sine of sine square of the mixing angle. Here we have the delta m squared. But in this region, there is a problem because the reactor results, which are marked by these two lines, disfavor a lot of quite big region on this plot. Also, there is there are the measurements of the solar neutrinos marked by this line, which also disfavor this region. And here, this upper corner of this plot is disfavored by Katrin experiment. So these results are really in strong tension with everything. And we don't know if that oscillation, that may be some underestimated detector effects or wrong cross-section for the neutrino. This needs more investigation. So this is not yet the confirmation of existence of sterile neutrinos. And the last anomaly is the LSND or mini-boon. This is called low energy excess because they observed the excess of electron neutrinos in the region of low energies. And here the explanation can come from the new program in Fermilab, the liquid argon detector, because it may happen that this excess is caused by misidentified photons, which was difficult to determine in the old detectors. If we incorrectly model some of the photon productions, like for example, some special decay of the delta resonance, then it can be probably explained, this excess can be probably explained by underestimation of this decay resonance, of this delta resonance decay. But if this excess really comes from electrons produced by electron neutrinos, then maybe this oscillation signal, maybe it is something else. We still don't know. So Fermilab built three detectors based on the liquid argon technology, which are located on the same beam with different baselines. The beam is similar to T2K and NOVA, muon neutrinos and antineutrinos, and they can study appearance and disappearance of electron neutrinos, antielectron neutrinos, muon neutrinos, and antimuon neutrinos. And first results from this program were published by Microboon detector. Microboon is the middle one, so this is the beam of neutrinos in Fermilab. Here is the detector closest one, which should start to take data this year. Here is the Microboon, which already published data and stopped data taking. And here is Icarus, the biggest one, which is currently taking data, but not published any results yet. So Microboon performed four independent searches looking for the reason of the low energy excess. So the searches covered the hypothesis of that it's going coming from the electrons or from the photons. And in case of the electron searches, they rejected the electrons as the sole explanation at over 97%. But also in the photon search, they disfavor this decay, which was suspected to cause this excess as the sole source at 95%. So on the one hand, they confirmed that the background in the old experiment was calculated correctly. But on the other hand, they do not see the low energy excess where it is expected to be. So they performed the oscillation analysis, assuming 3+1 scenario, 3+1 sterile neutrino, and they saw no evidence of sterile neutrino oscillation. Here on this plot, you can see the excluded region of the oscillation parameters marked by the red line for two oscillation channels. The blue regions are the regions allowed by the older experiment. So first results say no evidence, but in the future, hopefully near future, we will get the results from these three detectors with improved sensitivity, and we hope that this red line will be moved and exclude or confirm the existence of sterile neutrinos. So that would conclude my talk. I hope I convinced you that we are in the era of precise measurements in neutrino physics. We have the precision of few percent for most parameters, and we are really, really struggling with the controlling of the systematics, because when the number of events we collected increases, then really controlling the systematics becomes more and more crucial. There are many efforts to suppress these effects, and we hope that in the near future, before the Dune and Hyperkite start, we really be prepared for the new data. The unknowns in the oscillation physics are targeted by many experiments, some mass ordering by the reactor experiment, atmospheric experiments, and also beam experiments, the octant theta 3 by atmospherics and long baseline experiment, and the CP violation by the long baseline experiments currently running and the preparing to start running in the near future. The existence of sterile neutrinos is targeted by the Fermilab program, but also there are other measurements, which I didn't mention, done by Katrin experiment, reactor experiment, and others. So we have rich program for the near future, many planned experiments already in construction, which should start taking data before 2030, and really very exciting time ahead of us. Thank you.
Thank you very much for this very comprehensive review. And questions, please.
During the talk, I was thinking all the time about this magic number of three flavors. But then at some point you've mentioned that there is probably the fourth flavor possible. But then a natural question is that maximum, or perhaps fifth flavor could be considered, or sixth one?
As far as I remember, for the stellar neutrinos, there were
studies performed for 3+2, but I'm not sure if anyone tried to do it for larger number, because the calculations really become much, much more complicated. You have to include much more mixing angles and new CP phases, and this really at some point when you are increasing the number of possible neutrinos, you really can lose the sensitivity to the parameters, because you have many effects overlapping and you cannot distinguish which effect is causing something. So I know that 3+2 were
no such general rule, like the maximum is very defined.
No, I don't think so.
Bożena.
I have two questions or a question, a comment. I'm not sure if I'm correct, because I don't remember this very well, but I think at the very beginning, that was mostly astronomers who claimed that that neutrino oscillations are needed, because otherwise there was a huge disagreement between the model of the sun, I mean the nuclear reactions, and then the measured neutrino flux.
Okay.
And then the actual question is, you mentioned this Chinese experiment, mm-hmm. and the question is, are you a member of this experiment,
no.
or Chinese are not that open to invite people from Europe?
They are open. These collaborations, I spoke about the two Chinese experiments. Both experiments are international. They are only located in China. Chinese people are prevalent, but they are open. I'm not a member. Polish neutrino community is more focused toward Japanese experiments. And if I can comment about this solar neutrinos, yes, this was the solar neutrino problem. However, just from this early measurements of the solar neutrinos, you could not say if it is neutrino oscillations or maybe neutrino decay or some other process. So the confirmation that this is oscillation came in 2001, I think it was done by the SNOW experiment, which measured the total number of the electron of the neutrinos of all flavors coming from the sun. And that was in agreement with the predictions, and that confirmed that neutrinos did not decay or were lost somewhere. They came, but with different flavor.
Yes, Maciej.
So a question more from the theoretical side. So if there is a fourth type of neutrino, I'm trying to understand how it would be related to the standard model, because the three types we know are related to the three leptons that we know that exist and are well within the standard model. What would be the fourth neutrino related to, if it existed, how it would fit?
Okay, I'm not a theoretician, so maybe I will simplify too much. But in general, this neutrino is believed to be right-handed and not coupled to Higgs boson. To W and Z. So it's not, it can only show its existence through oscillations, through disturbing of the oscillations of the active neutrinos.
So that would be beyond the standard model.
Yes.
Is that correct? So, okay, thanks.
Other questions? Yes, please.
Thank you. I wanted to ask if at this because it would be a question from someone who didn't have much experience in this topic. I just had a 30 hours lecture on particle physics. So, but what is special about neutrinos that we see oscillation of neutrinos and we do not see it for leptons like electrons, muons, tauons, like only the small masses or something?
Well, for not yes, I mean, you can imagine that the electron is somehow oscillates into mu of the same charge, but yes, the main reason is that they are neutral. But probably I don't remember something very very basic, so I really don't know how to answer your question right now. Why neutrinos and not other leptons? What?
Due to mass.
Yeah, but
because quarks actually, they are oscillating, but I mean up quark, down quark also oscillating, but it's not because of charge. I think because of mass difference. Actually, they are in principle they are oscillating. The electron, muon, and tau, they are oscillating. But phenomenologically, it is not actually obvious to like neutrino. That's what I mean.
While quarks are oscillating, you mean they exchange gluons and they change colors, yeah?
No, not gluon, actually. Like neutrino, quark sector also oscillating.
Okay.
So like it's kind of like the same, exactly same pattern. In the quark and the neutrino and the lepton has the same actually pattern as the quark, like up quark and down quark actually pattern. So it is, in principle, it is the lepton like also oscillating.
But the fact that quarks
are... I'm sorry, but quarks have different charges and they certainly do not oscillate.
No, they are oscillating.
You mean the mixing of quarks, this.
Yeah, mixing.
How you can imagine a quark with charge, with one charge oscillate into a state with another charge?
No, no.
That's not possible.
Not this. Okay, thank you for the question, because I was not thinking about that for a long, long time, and I really forgot, because I'm sure that the answer is simple, but I simply... don't remember.
Okay, let me ask if there are questions from Zoom, maybe. We have audience on Zoom. I can't see, so I have one question, which is about experiments, because you mentioned this atmospheric neutrinos that are coming from the cosmos. Yeah, so is there any like a correspondence to cosmic ray experiments, or you exchange some phenomenology or?
Okay, so the atmospheric neutrinos are not coming from the cosmos, but they produced by the primary cosmic rays
by the reactions.
So. These experiments which I mentioned these experiments Ice Cube and KM3Net are also measuring the cosmic rays. In particular, in case of KM3Net, in fact, I didn't mention that, but they will have two sides. One side is dedicated to the measurements of the neutrino oscillations. It's called ORCA. But the other side, which is more space instrumented and called ARCA, is dedicated to the studies of the astrophysical high energy neutrinos and also high energy cosmic rays, because they are the background, like the muon bundles are the background to the neutrino studies. So yes, and they also published the results about the cosmic rays and these high energy neutrinos, but it is not my field of experience.
Okay, thank you.
Can I have
yes.
Question? Actually, in experimental side, they confirm the mass of neutrino hierarchy of mass of neutrino and the mixing angle, like small mixing angle, like quarks. they confirm the mass of the neutrino and the mixing angle all together in experiment?
The oscillation experiments cannot measure the mass itself. They mass are sensitive to delta m square, so they can provide the differences of the between the mass states, but do not measure the actual value of the neutrino mass. This is done in different experiments. For example, like 2 years ago, I think Katrin experiment started as the new experiment, which is doing that, and they published the new results, if I remember correctly, that the effective electron neutrino mass is lower than 0.something electronvolt. But oscillations experiment cannot do that.
Mixing angle also just small or
the like mixing what? Angles, in fact, in case of neutrinos, the mixing angles are quite big. Let me find the proper slide here. So one of them is maximal. So theta 3 is close to maximal. Theta 1, 2 is quite big. Theta 1, 3 is the smallest one, but still it's considered in our community quite big. So the mixing angle is much bigger than for quarks.
Thank you very much.
Okay, I think we can conclude. If there will be more questions, you are welcome to come downstairs or upstairs and ask our guest. And thank you very much for your seminar. And yeah, see you next time.